Welcome. Good afternoon. Thank you for coming to our Lunch and Learn. This is presented by the Office of Interprofessional Education and Practice, as well as our USF Health Simulation Consortium Committee, for which I'm the chair. We are celebrating healthcare simulation this week. SSH, provides us with this great healthcare simulation week that we've had a lot of activities planned, such as a moulage contest and a lot of social media presence. So this Lunch and Learn is a part of that. The theme of this year's week is to be a champion of your own success story. And so today we're presenting on the highlights of the integration of experiential learning into our healthcare professional curricula. We have five presenters. This is a panel discussion, and we hope to showcase all of the great things that we have done over the past year within our USF Health programs. And first, we're going to introduce ourselves. We can go to the next slide. So I am Eleanor Rawson. I am a nurse anesthetist, and I am assistant professor within the College of Nursing. I am the simulation coordinator for our CRNA program for the past 3 years, although I've been with the program a little longer. And I really enjoy simulation with our students. It's a great time for them to get their feet wet and get that hands-on practice that they need with, high fidelity situations.
Good afternoon and welcome. My name is Dawn Schocken. I am the Director of Experiential Learning Simulation at the Morsani College of Medicine.
Hello and welcome. Thank you for joining us. My name is Donna McDermott. I am Professor of Nursing and Associate Dean of Simulation and Experiential Learning at the College of Nursing. And I'm very happy to share with you today a little bit about our programs and how we're using simulation to benefit training for our students.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Frank Whitaker, and apologies because my video is not working. But I have been at CAMEL since 2018, and I work as a coordinator on our national curriculum courses. So those courses include like the central line course that almost all PGL1 residents go through before they start on July 1. We also host the advanced trauma life support course, and we also host FCCS, Adam and Asset, and I also work with a gynecologic course called MIGS, Minimally Invasive Gynecologic Surgery. So thank you everyone for being here.
Hi, good afternoon. I am Erini Serag-Bolos. I'm an associate professor at the Tanasia College of Pharmacy. I coordinate interprofessional education activities and also work with the Simulation Governance Consortium. Welcome and thank you for joining us this afternoon.
So these are our objectives for our session today. We will discuss how experiential learning activities enhance our learners' journey to becoming healthcare professionals. We will synthesize the multiple methods of experiential learning that are used by USF Health to enhance our learners' education, as well as analyze the tools used by our educators at USF Health to improve our patient care outcomes due to the incorporation of our experiential learning.
So as part of my role as being the Director of Experiential Learning, I oversee all of the years 1 through 4 curricula where we try and enhance their learning journey by giving them hands-on skills. So one of the things that we do is we have 4 longitudinal courses, Doctoring 1, Doctoring 2, Doctoring 3, and Doctoring 4, which allows the medical student an opportunity to begin to learn their journey towards becoming a physician. Their activities include learning how to speak to patients, learning how to examine patients, learning how to pull together their critical reasoning and clinical thinking with a standardized patient. We have an extensive standardized patient program here at Morsani College of Medicine with over 160 very well-trained standardized patients who provide interactive activities with our learners. Additionally, this helps amplify their muscle memory as they're learning their tools and of the trade to becoming a physician. Next slide. So our SPs are taught how to provide feedback. We do extensive studying, both one-on-one with our SPs, as well as small group sessions with our SPs, so that when they go off to work with all of the USF Health students, pharmacy, nursing, PAs, athletic training, DPTs, and medical students, as well as our CRNAs, they have an opportunity to both provide a feedback to the students on their clinical skills and be a member of the team that's helping to teach. Our faculty observe our students performing physical exam skills so that prior to actually working with physical, with real patients, actual patients, they have extensive skill set so that they're not curious or wondering how to approach a patient or how to examine a patient. We run many, 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 many OSCEs and clinical performance exams that help our course directors understand and examine what the learners are learning by measuring the student's critical reasoning skills. A student participates in an OSCE as early as their first year and continues all the way through their fourth year and then into residency. We also have OSCEs. We run open skills labs in two spaces, both at MDD and at CAMELS, that allows the students to practice their skills. They learn a variety of different skills, whether it's surgical skills, OBGYN skills, neurology, internal medicine, pediatrics. All of our different subspecialties wind up having simulation activities that they do with their third year and fourth year students. USF Health Morsani College of Medicine additionally was foundational in helping to organize and develop the 16 interprofessional educational modules that are taught throughout USF Health. We start with first year skills, learning how to talk together in teams, roles and responsibilities within each of our professions. We move into values and ethics and practice case management with standardized patients so that everybody is understanding when they work in a clinical setting, what that looks like from values and ethics. We work with our third and fourth year learners practicing communication skills and working in teams, learning how to communicate across teams and within teams, and sharing handoffs and knowledge, as well as recognizing when there might be a potential problem with our patients and using our various tools to alert our team members that we are worried about a patient safety event. And then we finish up with finalized activities, learning disaster management skills, learning patient safety skills, and working with our learners in a variety of different manners. Next slide.
Okay, so I'm going to talk about the College of Nursing, and we are at the Health Partnership Complex right now, which is formerly known as the Shriners Hospital on USF Pine Drive on main campus. And we moved into this space in April of 2023. You may or may not know, we are building a new nursing school and simulation center. And so while construction is occurring, we needed a place to have our simulation all together in one spot. So we have a lot of space there. We're very happy with the facilities. Our students really like it because it's like a real hospital. And we fully support all of the nursing undergrad and NP programs, and then some of our other USF health programs. We have 6 high fidelity rooms, several debriefing rooms, and small gathering spaces, 2 multi-purpose skills rooms that we use for some of our grad skills and procedures, 8 exam rooms, and then 7 learning labs for our health assessment and fundamentals of our undergrad program. And you can see in that one picture on the bottom right, we do old school with the sim screen because we do not have control rooms. We have the sim screens that we use to conduct the simulation right in the patient room. Next slide, please. So our undergrad program, we have the HPC building, but we also have sim at the St. Pete and the Sarasota campuses. And the top 2 pictures are St. Pete, where they have a lab, and they do some minor sim. They do come to Tampa campus for their high fidelity simulation. And then Sarasota, we also have a learning lab there. We use our learning labs for our fundamental and health assessment skills. And then throughout all of our clinical courses, we use multiple modalities. We use standardized patients from the College of Medicine. We use high fidelity mannequins, task trainers, combination of different modalities. We are very excited because this year we implemented a new senior level multiple patient scenario to kind of get at those hard clinical judgment and prioritization skills that nurses are needing as they're graduating and going on to their new professional role. And that's been going very well, wildly popular with the students. Our graduate program NPs use HPC also, and then Dr. Rawson is going to talk about anesthesia in a little bit. And they are embedded throughout the clinical courses. They do boot camps of skills, procedures, central lines, things like that. They also do clinical judgment scenarios and the OSCEs, and they use our exam rooms and our multi-purpose rooms for that. Next slide. And also very exciting, we started with our mobile unit in the spring, which goes out in the community and provides care to patients. And Dr. Kat Nadeau started conducting simulation with her students prior to going out on the van. So this was a lot of her doctoral work that she had done in the past. And so we actually had simulation on the van in the springtime where the students got to go in and see what the environment was like and do these simulations. So that was kind of fun for all of us and exciting. Next slide. So the College of Nursing and HPC also supports our interprofessional utilization of the space through space, equipment, and personnel for the other USF colleges, athletic training, the physician assistants, physical therapy, pharmacy does a lot of interviews there. And I think there is some public health, maybe not running right now, but I think they have in the past. So we are full house out at HPC. So that's good. Next slide. And I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Rawson to talk about CRNA.
Okay. So our CRNA program is 9 semesters, and our learners go through simulation 5 credits during their semesters 3, 4, and 5. So towards the beginning, but kind of right in the middle of their program. We have 3 semesters for actually a total of 110 hours of simulation for that throughout the entire year. We have 50 students in a cohort currently, but starting in January, we're going to have 60 students that will start this year simulation lab. So we have definitely upped our numbers. We start in the spring with a sim boot camp, which gets them ready for clinical, which I'll talk about in a couple slides. And that's really the highlight of our simulation program. The first semester also includes the basic foundational skills, such as airway skills, airway management, and then bread and butter type cases, which are not, you know, which are seen as easy cases, but they are typically what the students are put in during those first couple of days of clinical. So that first semester, they're just learning the flow and the rhythm of anesthesia and the order that we do things. And this is their time in simulation to kind of learn that and adjust to that. In Sim Lab 2, which is over the summer, we focus on the lifespan, obstetrics, pediatrics, geriatrics, and they start to get more skills under their belt, more procedures with spinals, epidurals, and we have a 2-week regional anesthesia lab that we use standardized patients to do ultrasound scanning of, as well as many task trainers that they can practice these skills. Our fall sim lab is more of an advanced lab. Everything's scaffolded and everything's built throughout the year. And we get more and more complex as we get through. The patients get more complex in the scenarios and so do the skills. So this fall semester culminates with central lines, arterial lines, cardiac procedures, one lung ventilation with thoracic procedures. And then our final weeks of the whole year are with a porcine specimen cricothyrotomy lab that they can practice this skill. So the whole year really builds on each other. Next slide. To give you a little more information about what we do throughout the year, we align our coursework heavily with their didactic courses. So I get with the faculty of all the other classes that they take during that semester. Sometimes they'll be learning regional anesthesia on a Tuesday in class, and then they're hands-on on that Wednesday and Thursday. So sometimes we can even be as close to back-to-back as possible with their didactic work. Throughout the year, we have 20 high-fidelity scenarios that we almost exclusively use our Simman 3G Plus mannequin with. We do take some time. We borrow Sim Mom from Camels. We borrow Sim Baby just for 1 week, you know, looking at those lifespan over the summer type scenarios. Our students play roles. So the roles are very clearly delineated. Someone is in the hot seat every week. They don't know who it will be until they get to lab, until truly the end of in brief. We say, well, you're the CRNA today. And that's the person that's at the head of the bed. The other learners in the group, and we do small groups, there's only 6 to 7 students per group. The other students play the other roles, an OR nurse, an anesthesiologist, the scrub tech. So we have all these other roles that they help to enhance the scenario. So everyone's engaged in participating in the scenario, and they learn just as much as the person does at the head of the bed. They're evaluated on, we have adapted the Creighton competency evaluation instrument for every single scenario. So it's scenario specific. If it has to do with a cardiac case, all the clinical judgment part of that evaluation tool is relevant to those interventions that we've deemed, you know, the most important for that scenario. It also looks at assessment, and it's not graded. We don't use it as a grade. We use it for feedback to the learner as well as to guide our debriefs. Something that we really started this year, I just started instituting it over the summer, the beginning of summer, is something called a psychological safety stop. We are calling it a safety stop. The more that I read about psychological safety and decompression, it really applies to our students. We've seen our cohorts change over the last few years. There seems to be a lot more anxiety in sim, a lot more, this is real because we make it real, right? It's high fidelity. We make it seem as real as possible with the environment and everything around them, but they take that to heart. It's putting them into a real situation. And so we've seen tears, we've seen pushback, even though we stress what happens in sim stays in sim and it's about learning experience. We really needed to do more to support our learners. So we instituted something called a safety stop. We take 5 minutes at the end of a scenario. I had polled them informally through our evaluations. I had polled them, and everybody's across the board on what they see this is. All the learners want something different because it's personal. Decompression time is personal. So after every single scenario, we say end scenario over the microphone, but then we say, all right, it's time for your 5 minute safety stop. Be back in the classroom for debrief at 9:32. We're very specific with this. So exactly 5 minutes, we want you back in the classroom. And that's really helped. They can do what they want. If decompression means to them going to the bathroom or having alone time or talking to their peers or calling, you know, somebody to give them support, whatever that means, they can do that in 5 minutes. So that's something new that we're really excited about that we've gotten a lot of positive feedback about. Our hands-on skills labs, I've kind of mentioned all of those that we have integrated. So typically we have one scenario and one skills lab, and then the students flip halfway through the lab experience. We have clinical discussions, and those are typically just in that first semester that we've embedded instead of hands-on skills labs, just because they don't have a lot of skills yet. They are working on the basic foundation, as I mentioned. So they're working towards it. We find the clinical discussions help to kind of bookend their learning. It's usually a complementary topic, not a redundant topic that's covered in the in-brief for their scenario, but it allows them a more small environment with faculty to kind of throw those questions back and forth that they might not be able to do in a larger class setting. And we have 4 faculty. It's a mix of full-time faculty and adjunct faculty. We have a very high adjunct faculty presence, which is great because our learners see them in simulation, and then they go out and they see them in clinical. We also bring in senior students to help us. So see one, do one, teach one. We bring in seniors out of clinical for 1 or 2 days a semester. They rotate and they are a facilitator now. They have been in simulation, so they know the content and they know how it's going to be presented. And then they've seen it in real life and clinical experience. So they're able to bring that. So our senior students really do help our junior students kind of push their learning. And then we do weekly lab evaluations. So weekly, I send a Qualtrics evaluation, and they're able to give us feedback. We are very much a 360-degree evaluation program, and this is very evident in our simulation as well. So we take their feedback. We try to make things better around the clock, and if it's even making it better for the next immediate lab session, we will try and do whatever we can. Next slide. And then this is a simulation boot camp that we do for entry to clinical. It's over the first 5 weeks that we do the formative assessments and we build our knowledge and learning. And then during week 6, we have an objective structured clinical evaluation. We have our OSCE, and they have to pass these 4 main areas in order to go into clinical during the next week. So we hold them for clinical the first 6 weeks, and they go into clinical only once they successfully pass each of these sections. We look at preoperative assessment with standardized patient, anesthesia machine checkout, making sure the machine is ready to go for the day, which is a daily requirement in anesthesia practice. Top drawer medications includes the pharmacology of all of our drugs, both induction anesthetic drugs, as well as emergency medications. And then basic induction of anesthesia. It means going to sleep. If the patient comes in the room to when you put the patient on a ventilator and you have stopped their breathing and you are keeping them asleep with anesthetic gases. So those 4 main areas they need to test out on. They're timed, very heavy rubric, very strict rubric, and they need to pass all 4 sections to go into clinical. We have found this to be very successful as far as turning their next clinical day, their first clinical day, into a hands-on, they're actually doing stuff kind of day, as opposed to a shadowing day or a step back and watch day. They're actually able to start and hit the ground running their first day of clinical. I think that's all for us for the CRNA program. So I will turn it over to Dr. Serag-Bolos.
Right, thank you, Dr. Rawson. As far as the Tanita College of Pharmacy, so just a little bit of background, we have recently switched over to a modified block curriculum, and we continue to utilize simulation, multiple modalities of simulation throughout the curriculum. From the beginning of the first year, throughout the first 3 didactic years, and then leading the students into their experiential years within their 4th year of rotation. So starting off, just thinking about what our accreditation standards are, guidance in relation to simulation modalities. So we focus on utilization of standardized patients or standardized persons. Oftentimes, this would be in the context of either patients or as providers if the students are verbally giving recommendations, as well as virtual reality platforms, artificial models and mannequins, and task trainers, specifically when we're thinking about inhalers and techniques and medication administration techniques. And lastly, artificial environments. Next slide, please. Most of the simulations occur within the pharmaceutical skills series, so I've had the opportunity to work with several colleagues throughout the series in implementation of various simulations that align with what the students are learning within their pharmacotherapeutics. So focusing on the various disease states and organ system modules, as well as patient communication skills, and within the spiral aligned curriculum, enhancing or increasing the difficulty of concepts and having students become more involved as they progress through the curriculum. So as you can see here with the slide, just utilization of the various modalities, virtual reality, and I'll go into a little bit more details within the next slides, but using the virtual reality has helped us to bring some of the pharmaceutical sciences concepts to life, especially thinking about pharmacology and how medications work at various receptors. Virtual reality has also been used for communication, medication administration techniques, And then as the students continue further into communication and patient counseling, giving recommendations, is where we start working more so with the mannequins, the artificial environments, and the standardized patients. Next slide, please. All right, so taking a look at virtual and augmented reality, and really looking forward to the opportunity to partner up further with CAMLS and exploring additional opportunities here. In the past, and what you see depicted is a Second Life program, which was a virtual reality program that we had used in the past, but it's a script-based system. So the students were not able to dialogue directly with the system, but rather type out what their questions would be or what their comments would be. And then using the virtual reality, it would respond back to the students. So with this, we covered such components such as patient counseling, providing education about medications, how to appropriately administer and use various techniques, as well as some opportunities for physical assessment as well with shadow health. And then the other item that's listed here or depicted here on the slide towards the right-hand side is a prescription label. So this is just an example of an activity that would occur with first-year students as they're learning how to interview a patient and how to counsel, as well as what are the various components that should be on a prescription. So trying to have them practice that in a virtual reality setting and then face-to-face with a standardized patient and then continuing on within the curriculum. Next slide, please. All right, included here an example of a simulation that involves just working within a sim setting and with a standardized patient as well. As the students advance and progress through the curriculum, trying to bring larger concepts to life and making sure that they're able to connect between what they had learned in previous years compared to where they are in the current year. So this is an example of an activity that depicts the pharmacist patient-centered care process, as the students would follow a patient from the moment of their admission into the emergency room, addressing the needs that would need to occur there, to an ICU setting, to a medical floor, and then lastly, preparing for discharge in a long-term care facility. For this particular activity, it is timed. The disease states that were included would incorporate what they were currently learning in their advanced years within the pharmacy curriculum, as well as reaching back to what they had previously learned and incorporating multiple concepts such as interprofessional practice, who else do we need to work with on the team, what is the pharmacist's specific role in that particular setting or environment, and also lastly here too, pulling in components of layered learning. So for several of the simulations, we also include not only faculty, but also fourth year pharmacy students, bringing them in from rotation and having them share their experience and help guide the students along with their thought process as well. Next slide, please. All right, and then lastly, as far as artificial environments and with the use of standardized patients as well, just to highlight some additional examples. As I mentioned, several of the simulations within the skills courses do align with the integrated pharmacotherapeutics course. So the students would learn concepts within class and then be able to come in and apply them within the lab environment. So within the lab environment, having both formative and summative assessments, and then towards the end of each semester also there are a little bit more higher stakes exams that are administered in a simulated fashion. Some of the specialty areas that we have conducted simulation within relate to renal replacement therapy, critical care, oncology, thinking about aseptic technique, trying to incorporate calculations within the simulation as well. And then of course, interprofessional education. Next slide, and I'll go ahead and hand it off to Mr. Whitaker. Thank you.
Thank you. So I'm going to talk about CAMLS. USF Health CAMLS was built in 2012, and it's a 90,000 square foot facility with simulation and bioskills labs, including classroom space. It's a standalone center in downtown Tampa, and it's part of the new health technology corridor. Some of our clients include GME, UME, CRNA, hospitals, universities, the military and industry clients. I was able to work with the MacDill Air Force Base on a Blue Horizon ATLS course just this past February. And so we're going to have them come back again next year to train with us again. We're looking forward to it. So CAMELS is a nonprofit direct support organization for the University of South Florida. It's one of the largest facilities in the world, and it's exclusively dedicated to training and research for healthcare professionals at the local, national, and international level. CAMELS was designed to bridge the gap between academia and private industry to facilitate transformative innovations in healthcare technology, research, and education. It's also accredited by the Society for Simulation in Healthcare and the American College of Surgeons. And we hold a few of the American College of Surgeons courses like ADAM, Advanced Trauma Operative Management for PGY4s, and ASSET, Advanced Surgical Skills for Exposure and Trauma for PGY3s. Next slide, please. So CAMELS' vision is improving healthcare through lifelong education and training. And the mission is to create and provide experiential learning that improves clinical skills and patient care in our community and around the globe. Next slide, please. We have many clinical simulation capabilities. We have simulated hospital and clinical space for neonatal, pediatric, adult patient, outpatient simulation training, and medical device studies. Our training rooms feature video recording with large monitors for real-time feedback, discussion, and debriefing. We have multiple patient exam rooms for standardized patient encounters, and we have plenty of private debriefing rooms after the simulation. We have access to 38 high-fidelity adult, child, infant simulators, combat casualty, and birthing simulators. We have multiple high fidelity and virtual reality simulators that enable the honing of specific surgical skills, including endoscopic, laparoscopic, interventional, vascular, urologic, and gynecologic procedures. We also have access to more than 200 highly experienced standardized patients to enhance any simulation.
Thank you, panelists, for taking the time to share the info about not only CAMELS, but each of your programs' curricular structures as it relates to the very robust simulation experiences your programs have created. Okay, we have one question. I'll open it up to all of the panelists. It says, in addition to teaching, do you use your simulation environments for operational test and evaluation of new processes and procedures?
I know that we do that at CAMELS. I'm not sure if Frank wants to speak to that, but we do have a number of industry partners who come in and test their products prior to going to the FDA for approval.
Someone else in the chat said that we do system testing as well at TGH.
Yeah. All right. If there's no further questions, I hope you've enjoyed this presentation. Really just highlighting everything that we're doing in simulation across USF Health. But we are thankful that you've attended our Lunch and Learn. And if you have any questions, you can reach out to any of us as well if there's any follow-up questions. But I guess that's it for us. I hope you all have a great day. Thank you.